Hey, how are you? I'm Slice of Otaku, and with this video, I want to talk to you all about combustion bending. And this is one of the many subfacets of bending that we have briefly touched upon in the past, but this time around, I'd certainly like to go a bit further in depth with it. Now, first and foremost, the simplest question we could begin to ask ourselves would be, what is combustion bending? And in the case of this ability, that question is rather perplexing as compared to what would be the case for virtually all other bending styles. As a layman unfamiliar with the Avatar series, if I had the concept of bending generally described to me, I would more than likely be able to assume the basic properties of something like lava or blood bending, for instance. However, I'd imagine the term combustion would be somewhat difficult to differentiate from that of fire. But even still, at the very least, would be on the right track, as combustion bending is a subfacet of fire bending. What's more, is that similarly to how its name stands out amongst the crowd, combustion bending is one of the rarest bending styles in the world. Over the course of both The Last Airbender and The Legend of Korra, we have only ever been exposed to combustion benders, both of which only being around for so long respectfully. Not to mention that only one of them actually spoke and was presented with a proper name. This one, of course, being Plea of the Red Lotus. Now, to be fair, in the case of lava bending, we do only receive two true lava benders in the form of Gazan and Bolin, but thanks to the presence of the Avatar, lava bending has a bit more going for it. All of which we thoroughly explained in a previous video I highly suggest you check out if you haven't already. But, interestingly enough, similarly to how lava bending as a subclassification of bending seems to stem from an innate bodily prerequisite as opposed to a tutelage-based one, the very same appears to be the case for combustion bending, as both Combustion Man and Plea were described to have displayed their abilities during adolescence. But what is truly remarkable about this style of bending is that I find it not only shares similarities with the foundation of lava bending, but also lightning bending. Or at least the redirection of it as devised by Uncle Iroh. When teaching Prince Zuko, Iroh cites his influence to be that of water bending and its ability to redirect energy. And so with this in mind, what if I told you that combustion bending similarly shares properties of air bending? Well, going back to our earlier discussion of its name, I believe it's important for us to establish the definition of the word combustion. Merriam-Webster defines the word combustion to be an act or instance of burning, yet again, somewhat standing to conflict with the basic concept of firebending. However, Encyclopedia Britannica describes combustion to be, quote, a chemical reaction between substances, usually including oxygen, and usually accompanied by the generation of heat and light in the form of flame. The rate or speed at which reactants combine is high, in part because of the nature of the chemical reaction itself, and in part because more energy is generated than can escape into the surrounding medium, with the result that the temperature of the reactant is raised to accelerate the reaction even more. Now, this is more like it, especially when substituting chemical terms with spiritual ones. With fire being the element of power, firebending may at times more so be fueled by anger and rage as opposed to spirituality. And this was most certainly the case during the Hundred Year War. Combustion bending as we know it appears to be spirituality weaponized in a way not all too dissimilar from the mechanized spirit cannon present in Korra Book 4. The third eye tattoos possessed by such benders aid in the further concentration of the light chakra that deals with insight. This concept appearing to be the consolidation of airbender tattoos that would otherwise run along all the body's various chakra points. Combustion Man prior to an attack may be seen breathing in deeply before delivery, pulling in that energy for subsequent release. And what's interesting is that when first facing Team Avatar, when Combustion Man began to do this, even without any prior understanding of combustion bending itself, Aang immediately leapt into action in defense of his comrades. As an airbending master, Aang possessed a deep understanding of such chi-based breathing techniques, to the point of being able to tell the difference even across great distances. Just as Toph was able to sense the presence of others and act as a human lie detector as an earthbender so connected to the earth. And this happens not once, but twice. Now, mind you, the light chakra, as explained by Guru Patik, deals with the illusion of worldly separation, such as the division of the four elements. So for this technique to inherently blur such lines makes total sense to me. And as someone enlightened in this respect, I can understand why the ideology of the Red Lotus was able to find purchase in the mind of Plea beyond what would have been a direct resultant of her childhood liberation from captivity. And if all that wasn't enough, visually, their whole shaved heads aesthetic is rather Air Nomad-like, isn't it? But with all that being said, combustion bending is a pretty lethal capability. Not only did Combustion Man blow off two of his own limbs by accident when his abilities were first manifesting, but both he and Plea died to effective self-destruction, both of which, despite being pretty brutal, were brilliantly due to a lack of proper vision, which yet again goes back to the whole insight versus illusion concept behind the light chakra. As far as I'm concerned, combustion bending is the closest the Avatar world gets to firearms, without, you know, being arms on fire. But yeah, the way combustion benders engage in combat is kinda like how a highly trained sniper would. The best that most targets of such assaults could hope for would be to obscure their shot and get themselves to safety. But arguably, that's what made Plea so much more dangerous than Combustion Man, as she was able to actually curve her blasts, allowing them to go beyond cover and such. But then again, circumstantially, her time period very much restricts her lethality, as with how widespread metal bending stood to be during the Age of Korra, enemy defenses stood to be far more flexible as well. And on top of that, you have a whole new generation of light-footed airbenders jumping all over the place as well. But even then, I don't think anyone really wants to fight a person that shoots extremely precise long-range explosive blasts that remain virtually invisible up until the point of contact. And additionally, Plea, unlike Combustion Man, did actually employ traditional firebending techniques from time to time, tending to do so as a means of defense and redirection in ways that mirror the understanding of waterbending redirection Uncle Iroh spoke of. And she did this against a full-grown dragon. That light chakra is really no joke. But there you have it, guys, combustion bending explained. It's pretty much a superpower among superpowers that doesn't even require a dazzling display of martial arts to cause mass destruction. I really hope you guys enjoyed the video and can forgive me for the lack of uploads over here. We have just recently hit 300,000 subscribers, and I am so very grateful to you all for your incredible support over the years. Additionally, my other channel that is dedicated to anime and manga content, Plot Armor, just hit 100,000 subscribers as well. So at the very least, it looks like we're gearing up to close out 2020 on a good note. Now, to be honest with you, as the sole editor of these two channels, it can at times be hard to balance uploads. But for now, I'm aiming to have at least one upload a week for you over here. Hopefully, I can at some point find a suitable editor to lessen the load, but until then, thank you for bearing with me. And if you'd like to be here for what's to come, go ahead and subscribe to the channel and hit the bell for notifications so you know when we upload. With all that being said, thank you all so much for watching and have an awesome day. I love you.